I just woke up from a nap. I just brushed my hair barely. The makeup is still in what position it was on this morning, and that's what you're gonna get because I like to be in my true form when I do one of these things. Hi, I'm Carrie. I'm a mess. I have a fat neck. In case anybody's planning on strangling me, make sure you have big hands. I have a pacemaker, and I've had one since 2015. I had it put in when I was 25 years old. I've got a heart history. To make it all really, really simple, the reason I had it put in is because I was fainting due to rate drops. So even though I wasn't having bradycardia episodes, like really slow heart rates, it was more so that I would have like a heart rate of 130, 140 while I'm getting ready in the morning. And then it would drop suddenly to like 60 in the span of 2 beats. So in that amount of time, my blood pressure would tank. I'd faint, a lot of concussions, couldn't drive, impacting my work, my home life, everything. So I had a pacemaker installed. I had it put in when I was 25 years old, and I know beforehand I looked to YouTube, I looked to forums online to just try and get an idea. No matter how many times I found somebody my age who also had one, people who tried to put me at ease, I still just needed as much information as possible so that I could be prepared when I went in. I was worried not so much about the scar or the vanity of it, I think, because by that point I had had so many health events and my life, my quality of life had changed so much that I was okay with whatever they needed to do to get me back to a functioning state. I'll just kind of go over what the process was like, what the, you know, like things you should do beforehand, things to expect in the hospital, and then things afterwards. Disclaimer, since somebody always seems to be mad and yells at me, I'm not a doctor. This is my experience with the pacemaker implant. Yours will not be exactly the same as mine, but hopefully this maybe gives you a little bit of an idea what to expect, and hopefully you don't feel like coming back and yelling at me afterwards. So things to know on the front end. For anybody who's not been to a hospital before, when you get there, you typically sign 1,000 papers. They come in, they do an EKG, they get blood work done, they place an IV and just get you prepped. And then you start meeting with like the anesthesia team, your doctors, your nurses, whoever's gonna be with you during the procedure. Typically you do meet with somebody from the company. So like the hospital has someone either from like Medtronic or Biotronic or whatever company that you're device will be with. They usually have somebody from that come talk to you and like kind of show you. He had a sample of this that I was able to see like how big it was going to be, but just answer any questions that you have. And this is my first pacemaker. This is the Medtronic Advisa. I had this one just to like show you how small that is. Like it's pretty thin. Covering my serial number. but it's pretty thin. It's a pretty small pacemaker. It's about the size of a 50-cent piece, if anybody even knows what those still look like. The defibrillator ones obviously are bigger. This is a 2-lead. There are different sizes, different shapes. They do different things. This one is actually MRI compatible, which means that somebody comes and meets you at the MRI place if you need one, and they can actually set the pacemaker into a safe mode so that you can go through the scanner. Not all of them are like this. I don't know if all the new ones they're starting to make are like this, but this was the one that I had, and having that MRI compatibility came in handy because, like I said earlier, I'm messed up, but we're gonna stick with the heart stuff for now. And then your level of anesthesia will vary based on your health and what works for you. I know for me the first time they did like a twilight sedation. I still don't remember any part of it. And then I think the ones that I had after where they were repositioning it, I was on like inhaled gas anesthesia because it was a little more painful. They were putting it under the muscle. After the procedure, you wake up, they get your pain under control, they go over discharge instructions, and you get ready to go home. You will not be allowed to lift your left arm above shoulder height for 4 weeks. Weight limits, that I guess it, like they say you can't lift more than a gallon of milk or like 8 pounds. I think it's like 4 to 6 weeks. They'll tell you, but typically there's a weight restriction for lifting, and then you're not allowed to lift this arm above the shoulder for 4 weeks. And that's just so that those leads that are in your heart have a chance to really get in there, so you don't end up plucking them out by moving your arm or lifting or reaching above your head. For me, I sleep like this in bed. I sleep in all kinds of positions and usually wake up with my hands above my head. So for me, I had them give me a sling to wear at night so that if I tried to do that, I couldn't. I kind of strapped it in really tight. Sometimes they'll give you a sling. Usually they're hesitant to, because you can still move your arm. You can still move your shoulder. And if you're sitting there with your arm in a sling, you kind of tend to just not use it. I went back to work pretty quick afterwards, and I worked at a vet clinic, so lots of people handing you animals and picking things up. So I did have a sling during the day, which was kind of nice, because I did have like the muscles in my neck, my shoulder, and my chest started to get really tight. So I pulled the sling so that I had something to rest my arm in, but throughout the day I was still moving my arm, just keeping track of the fact that I'm not lifting it above the head, but also having that sling to rest my arm in afterwards. So typically they don't want you to. Sometimes they might send you home with one if you sleep with your arm above your head. If you do start to notice that it's really pulling, or that it's your muscles are really tense, maybe call your office and see if they're okay with you just putting your arm in a sling to be able to relax it while you're sitting up, with the idea that you are still gonna be moving this arm the whole time. There's gonna be no reason that you can't. If you're a side sleeper, a stomach sleeper, a weird anything but your back sleeper, you might have a little bit of trouble those first couple weeks, because you're not going to want to like lay on your side. You definitely don't wanna lay on your stomach. The most comfortable position I found is to lay with the affected side down and put pillows, like a body pillow, along this side of my body. And that allowed me to be at a little bit of an angle to kind of satisfy that need to sleep on my side or to roll over onto my stomach, without just being stuck and limited to laying on my back the entire time. So if that helps, if that's a good tip for anybody, then use that. Sometimes when you're on your back, it helps to put a pillow under this arm so that it's not laying back on the bed, because it can pull a little bit. The scar itself and the aftercare for it really was not that difficult. I had surgical glue. I was allowed to shower, I think, after like 24 hours, just to be really gentle, and then just wait until the glue came off. That was the first time. The second time, I had a like silver lawn bandage over it that was like the most adhesive thing that's ever been stuck. There's a previous video showing when I had it repositioned and how I got that bandage off with oil and rubbing alcohol. But I had a bandage on for 7 days that I could get wet, not like soaking in a tub, but I was allowed to shower with it. And then after 7 days, I was allowed to take the bandage off. I had skin glue underneath it that I just let flake off, and that was pretty easy. I didn't have to worry about cleaning anything. I didn't really have to worry about getting it wet, and was able to pretty quickly after I got home just resume like normal shower stuff. Scrubbing with one hand, or like trying to do this so I didn't have to lift this hand above my head. The healing, it does go pretty quick, surprisingly, as long as there's no problems with it. It did heal pretty quickly to the point where I could start putting a scar bandage on it. Believe it or not, this is really good for me for how I scar, and I use silicone scar away bandages that I put on them. Put scar cream, vitamin E, oil on it. I really don't care that I have this scar, because it does me such wonders to have this pacemaker. It doesn't even bother me. You'll leave the hospital with one type of setting, so like it'll tell your pacemaker when to go off, what kind of intervals. Everybody's will be different, but when you go to the doctor in like the 2 week mark to have it checked, if you're having any trouble, they can adjust the settings. If you're having a lot of trouble before then, you'll be in contact with them. So if you need them to change the settings, you can go in and have them do that. It's not uncommon to have to change a couple times to get it in the right spot. I think I changed my settings once the first time, and then when they put the new pacemaker in, I had to have them change it once again just to get it to the point where I was kind of feeling it when it would pace. It feels like a little flick right here on the inside. Not everybody's gonna feel anything at all, but they had me change it like one time and now it's perfect. So you may have to change your settings a couple times, but that's not uncommon. Once you're good to go and you're at home, you're not having to go back to the doctor's office a lot, you will be able to monitor from home with something like this. This is the base station that came with my first pacemaker. It actually came with my Link monitor, but it's the same one that I used for the pacemaker. And it just sits plugged in on your end table. I think every company has them a little differently. This one just uses the cell towers. So I don't have to pay anything for it. I just keep it plugged in. And then when I'm scheduled to send in transmissions, for me, it's every 3 months. I just pick this up, hold it over the pacemaker, and then it will transmit the data, send it to the office. It'll tell you when you have to pick it up, when to put it back down, and then it'll tell you once it's successfully been sent. Some people have to do it more frequently than others. And then I think one time when I had a weird episode, I immediately picked this up. I had called the office and had them send one of these in between my transmission date. But this is what comes with some of the pacemakers. They all look a little bit different. Or the one that I just had put in a few months ago is Bluetooth, of all things. So that's a little bit weird that my phone recognizes that there's a device. So far, I have not been able to airdrop my own boob a picture, but I'm working on it. But yeah, Bluetooth, which I guess if you're a conspiracy theorist, that's probably a nightmare to have a Bluetooth device implanted in your body. But hey, you know what? We're all gonna die from something, so maybe make it Bluetooth related. So for Medtronic, it's just an app and it Bluetooth connects, and then it sends whenever I need it to send, or it'll give me a notification saying it's time to transmit, and then it sends it to the doctor's office. So that's a little weird, but technology, right? Pretty cool. A lot of people ask me if I can feel the pacemaker, if I notice it. So this is the first one that I had and it sat right there. It was under the skin to start. I thought it was under the muscle because I thought that was our plan, but I think we ended up just putting it as close to the muscle as we could get while it was still in the fatty tissue layer. I have a big chest, so it kind of gets lost in the boob for me, so I didn't particularly feel it. If I pressed on it, I could feel it. If I moved my arm, I had no idea that it was there. I got used to it within like 2 days. By the time the swelling went down, it didn't feel foreign. It didn't feel like there was anything in there. It was a pretty natural transition for me. And when they put it under the muscle the second time around, a couple years later, when I had it repositioned, that was like, I could hardly feel where it was. But it's going to vary based on your body type, your body fat percentage, the way your chest is structured. You know, it just depends on your anatomy. I'm 5'9", so I'm a pretty big girl by comparison to some. So I think we have a little more real estate to work with than like my friends who are like 5 foot tall and their shoulders are probably like this far apart. So it is going to vary, but as far as just, does it feel foreign? No, not for me. It does not feel like there's something in there, especially after it got done healing. It's just like another part of me. I think I covered everything. I hope I did. I'm just trying to base this off of my own experience and see if I can do anything to be of help to somebody else. Hopefully I didn't miss anything, but anyway, that is my experience and I hope it helps somebody.